أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد والأهل بيته الطيبين الطاهر المعصومين واللانة الدائمة الباقي إلى أعدائهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين. Sisters and brothers in Iman, Salamun Alaikum wa Rahmatullah. I'd like to commend the brother for a very beautiful recitation, and that has already brought in a positivity in the atmosphere, inshallah, which will help me to carry on my discussion. The topic which has been given to me is the issue of a return to tradition. Before we talk about it, it's important to understand what do we mean by tradition and how do we place that in Islam in general. Normally when we talk about tradition, this is considered to be opposite of what is modern. Sometimes you have tradition versus progressive. Tradition is sometimes looked upon as looking back, whereas the opposite of that, modernity, would be looking forward. And this is where, you know, the discussion goes into a wider area of traditionalism versus modernity. It's a very vast topic, but we'd like to confine that within this idea of returning to tradition within the Islamic context. Let me explain one more thing. When we talk about tradition in Islam, we can actually look at this in three different dimensions of our faith. When we talk about tradition, as I said, you know, we always look back to our origin of the faith. There is one area, one dimension of faith, which has to do with aqidah, the belief system. When it comes to the belief system, there is no issue of traditional or modern. It doesn't change. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was one. He is one today. He will be one always. He will never become three. You know, and so when we talk about the nubuwwah of the Prophet, he was the last prophet. He is the last prophet. He will be the last prophet. When we look at the Quran, Quran is the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It will not change. The status of Quran in that way would always be same. So when we talk about aqidah, there is not really much, you know, issue of saying this is tradition or modern. It's only when we look at the practical aspect of our faith. There also I would divide it into two areas. When it comes to ibadat, there is kind of a mixture of tradition as well as change. There are many core things in our ibadat and rituals that we do, which will always remain constant, that they will not change. But there are some dimensions of that will change according to time and place. You look at the example of Salat, just to clarify what I mean by that. We know that Salat, you know, five times a day for a Muslim is wajib. It was wajib 1400 years ago. It is wajib now. It will be wajib as long as this world exists. That will not change. The method also is very interesting, that it will be the way we have been told, with some leeway given to us about selecting some of the recitations according to our choice. But there also limits have been put in there. But then you look at, for example, the dress that we will put on when we do our Salat. There, this is where you see that you do not necessarily have to go back to the tradition. This is where change would be allowed, provided modest, the dress fulfills the requirements of modesty and also taharat, as well as the issue of being mubah. So it doesn't mean that a Muslim must always wear Arabic clothes when they stand up for doing the Salat. So the Salat itself is a combination of what is tradition and what is change and manifesting in one place or the other according to the time and the space, impacts. It's more on the other side of the practice when we talk about mu'amalat, our lifestyle. That's where we see again there is a constant values, the core values of Islam will still be there, will not change. But its manifestation would change according to the time and the place that Muslims find themselves. You know, Islam didn't come to promote, Arab lifestyle as such. It is a world religion. It is a religion for the Arabs. It is a religion for the Persians. It is the religion for Indians, Indonesians, for Africans, for Americans. And they don't have to change their lifestyle. They will have to modify it. Because if it, as long as whatever, whether it's to do with dress code or other activities in our lifestyle and culture, as long as it doesn't conflict with the core values of Islam, there is this element of continuity as well as change, even in the muamalat and the lifestyle that we talk about. And so Muslims, basically, we find them to be in two camps, mostly. Two extremes when it comes to this issue of traditional versus modern. On one hand, we have rigid traditionalists who refuse to accept any change at all. They actually confine their religion to their own, time and frame, the way they learned about the faith. If they move from one place to another, they would like to replicate the exact same method in totality to their new home, for example. And this is where we come to realize that this is a challenge that we have. On the other hand, we have what we call naive modernists, who just go with whatever is now. That is the truth and nothing, nothing to do with, as soon as you say, but this is how we did, they say, oh, this is traditional. We don't believe in traditions. And so we have two extremes. And our faith in madhab is right there in the middle. That is the Salat al-Mustaqim. Let me just give you one example of traditionalists who are rigid and inflexible. And that is the extreme which we don't accept. Is that when they confine this dynamic spirit of Islam to one time and space. And the history and the example I would like to share with you is from the Ottoman history. Ottoman Empire was the last Muslim empire where the Turk Muslims ruled the Arab Middle East, North Africa, as well as Eastern Europe. Many Christian countries were under their control for many, many centuries. In late 15th century, we are looking at the example of Greece. The Greek Orthodox leaders, basically, who were in charge of running the schools for their own Greek children, they wanted to import printing press. Printing press was a new invention those days from Germany. In order to print the textbooks for their schools, for their, Christian schools that they had in Greece. But since this was a new thing, they needed permission from the Sultan, from the Muslim Sultan. And they sent a request to him that, we would like to import printing press machines. And the Sultan looked at it and said, this is a new mas'ala, so we'll ask the Mufti. Is it jaiz or not? And the Sheikh al-Islam, that was the title given in the Ottoman system to their marja or Mufti of the time, he looked at this issue and he said, well, we can allow them to import non-Arabic, non-Turkish printing press. So they want to have their Greece, textbooks. They can bring machines for that, but not for Arabic or Turkish printing machines. Of course, there was an element of, local economic perspective also, because if they bring the machines in, you have thousands of people who used to, whose job was to scribe and write, for others. So before that, whether it was in Greece or in the Muslim area of the Ottoman Empire, the books were actually copied by hand. You know, katib. This was a profession by itself. And so when you do it with hand, you know, you will not be able to bring in last, you know, mass quantity of the product. And so this Greek church running the schools in Greece decided to have this printing press. And the Mufti says, Arabic or Persian, Turkish press, we cannot allow that. Allow, you know, they can bring their own Greek printing press. This remained so for about 250 years. And what happened? For 250 years, with the blessing of a Muslim sultan, the Christian children of Greece were able to have easily available textbook for their schools. Whereas Muslim schools, under the Muslim sultan, were deprived of having, you know, mass production of their textbooks. And that had an impact. That had an impact on the literacy level and the, you know, academic level of, you know, the Christians in Greece under Muslim rule and the Muslim children under Muslim rule. This is where we see the rigidity of traditional perspective, where this Mufti didn't realize that Islam has some core values which continue, but its manifestation would change from time to time. Look at the Quran. The last revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala began with the word iqra, read. The second surah after that began with the words noon wal qalam. Reading in the first one, qalam is a symbol of, you know, instrument of writing. The second one, this is where Islam is saying, you know, this is a religion which is promoting literacy. The Prophet himself in the Battle of Badr, the very first battle where they had prisoners of war, you know, after other methods of releasing them, one of the issues the Prophet presented was that those mushrikeen, these are non-Muslim enemies, prisoners of war, but they had the talent of reading and writing. The Prophet said their freedom lies in the deal that they should teach each 10 children how to read and write. And this is where we come to realize that that core value of Islam, the traditional value of literacy and promoting literacy, is constant. It will never change with the passage of time and space. But the method of how do you promote literacy depends in the circumstances that you find yourself. This Mufti of the Ottoman Khilafat didn't realize that there is a core value of Islam which is constant, but it manifests in different ways. It doesn't have to be that the Qatib writing there and that is the only way of promoting knowledge. And that's where, you know, we have to realize that when we talk about return to tradition, which is, we have two extremes here. Traditionalism, in a sense, they don't want to see any change, and that is actually tying Islam to one time frame in history. But on the other hand, you know, we have the problem with, and that is the bigger problem I would like to talk about. I just wanted to get away with this traditional problem and deal with modernity as more the problem that we face during our own time. And these are the naive or ignorant modernists for whom everything old and traditional is bad, and everything new is automatically haqq. And this is the way to move forward. And this is where we have to realize, what does it mean when you talk about moving away from tradition and, you know, trying to adapt modernity as your new way of life? You know, this is not only an issue where Muslims are concerned about it. We have a problem even in the Muslim world, among the Muslim intellectuals also. They would like to go and change some of the core values of the faith. In the words of Shaheed Murtaza Mutahiri, he says, you know, They decode Islam with something which is not part of Islam. And they basically would like to present Islam in a way which, you know, it is not really anything to do with Islam. And so this is not only a Muslim problem. Even many faith-based philosophers who are not from Muslim background have this concern. A Canadian philosopher by the name of Margaret Somerville, she actually describes this whole issue of modernity as a dimension of intense individualism, where a person is only concerned about himself or herself. What I want, and I want it now. That is the beginning and end of their motto in their life. It is basically this reflection of self-centeredness, and they say, we don't care about what happened in the past. Don't talk to me about 1400 years ago. Don't talk to me about, you know, oh, this is the tradition that we have for centuries in our community, in our faith. What they don't realize that, you know, in English, when we use the term respect, this actually, the word respect, re-spect, these are two different words, originally coming from Latin. And what does it mean? It means to look back. In essence, if you really want respect, you have to look back. And looking back means what? Not to this poster here. We're talking about looking at your own past history, where you are coming from. What are the values, you know, that generations have brought all the way to your time? And this is where we have to realize that if we really want respect for ourselves, we cannot but always look back in order to chart our path in the future. Those modernists who only think about now only, and they would like to cut off their relationship with the past, actually have lost. They do not know what it means to have true respect. You know, there was a time when we talk about modernity, you know, it just means what is modern and what is now. Again, Shahid Murtaza Mutahiri, in his book on the system of women's rights in Islam, talks about this issue where he says, it's amazing that these modernists, if they lived a century ago, they would have said, okay, if women don't have the right to inherit, that's fine, because this is the modern way. Because what is modernity? What is modern today will become obsolete 20 years from now. So modernity just means what you are now. It's not really a strong base to, you know, live your life on that basis. You know, let me bring you not only Shahid Murtaza Mutahiri, but one of the comments, a very powerful statement from Dr. Hossein Nasser, where in one of his books he talks about this issue, and he says, these days we are often told that we must keep up with the times. Rarely does one ask, what have times to keep up with? We are told always to keep up with times. What is the basis for the time itself? For men who have lost vision of a reality which transcends time, who are caught completely in the mess of our time and space, and who have been affected by the historicism prevalent in modern European philosophy, it is difficult to imagine the validity of a truth that does not conform to their immediate external environment. Islam, however, is based on the principle that truth transcends history and time. Divine law is an objective, transcendent reality by which man and his actions are judged, not vice versa. What are called the times today are, to a large extent, a set of problems and difficulties created by man's ignorance of his own real nature and his stubborn determination to live by bread alone. To attempt to shape the divine law to the times is therefore no less than spiritual suicide, because it removes the very criteria by which the real value of human life and action can be objectively judged, and thus surrenders man to the most infernal impulses of his lower nature. To say the least, he concludes here, that the very manner of approaching the problem of Islamic laws and religion, in general by trying to make them conform to the times, is to misunderstand the whole perspective and the spirit of Islam. And so we realize that when we talk about going back to our roots, going back to the tradition, you know, you cannot be a Muslim if you do not look back to our origin. Sometimes there is a word, you know, amnesia. Amnesia means people who have lost their memory. Those modernists who only want to live by now and tomorrow actually are going through spiritual amnesia. They don't want to remember anything from the past. And this is where we have to realize, if you're talking about a faith and a religion, you cannot continue your Islamic identity without going back to your tradition. You know, this has not been a new thing in the modern Muslim history. There have been people who actually wanted to totally cut off their relationship to the past in the name of progress and advancement, especially after the First World War, in Egypt especially, and in Turkey. They were intellectuals, even people like Taha Hussein, a very prominent intellectual and writer of Egypt in the last century. He actually believed, by looking at the scientific progress in Europe, he used to very clearly say that if we as Muslims or Arabs would like to progress, we will have to totally adapt the Western lifestyle in its good as well as in its bad elements. He says we have to, you know, forget the past, move forward, and go with Europe. Look at Ataturk, the founder of modern Turkey, did the same thing. He wanted to cut off the relationship of his nation with the past. But the first thing he does is changes the script of the Turkish language from, you know, Alif Bata to Latin. And what happened? It's almost a century now, and they are trying again and again to become a member of the European Union. You know, just by changing your attire and putting on the European head, you don't become European. You know, this is where the entire approach was wrong. And this is where even the Turkish people now are trying to go back to their roots. And so the point is that when we talk about progressing and moving forward, we have to realize that we can and we should move forward. We should be progressive, but with the core values of our traditions, which should be the base of how we move forward. You know, Shaheed Murtaza Mutahhiri actually has a very powerful statement where he says, one should advance with progress of time, but also struggle against the decomposition and deviance of time. One should look to see from which origins new phenomena and changes arise forth, and in which direction they flow. Does the change arise from higher human drives of man, or from his lower human animal urges? Man can step abroad the vehicle of time and change, but he should not neglect the steering and the control of that vehicle even for a moment. Those who talk about changes of time and neglect to steer and control it have forgotten the role of the man himself in the transformation of his lifestyle, and are like the rider of a horse who has put himself under the control of the horse. A Shia of Ali does not go with the flow, doesn't change with the direction of the wind. A Shia of Ali actually always looks for the haqq, even if it is in the other direction. He doesn't follow the majority. Rather, he looks for what is haqq and what is the truth. And so, yes, you know, we need to move, you know, forward, but we can only chart our, you know, path in the future by looking back at our past. And that is the tradition which we have, you know, that will become our basis. You know, we are the Shias of Ali. We are the followers of the Imams of Ahlul Bayt. One of the very famous tawqi that we have from our Imam, Ajjalallahu Ta'ala, Farajahu Sharif, where he says, فَأَمَّا الْحَوَادِثُ الْوَاقِعُ. This is where you see past and present go hand in hand. He says, when it comes to the newly occurring situations, so this is modernity or modern situation, what do you do? فَرْجَوَ إِلَىٰ رُوَاتِ حَدِيثِنَا. He says, refer back. It's a new problem. It's a modern problem in the 21st century in the United States of America. But the Imam is saying, go back. Go back to our statements, in our hadith, in our Quran. You will be able to see the guidance in there, how to move forward. And this is where we had to go back to the tradition in order to understand our right path in the future. So let me conclude that, you know, my brothers and sisters, a Muslim is not bound to the time, he controls the time. A Muslim is not slave of time, he is the slave of Allah. A Muslim does not sit as a passenger in the vehicle of change, he drives it and steers it to the direction of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Otherwise, we will go into the path of what is known as worshipping our own self. You know, there is a verse in Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَرَعَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ هَوَاهُ إِلَاهُ هَوَا. Have you seen someone who has taken his own desires as his God? This phenomenon on an individual level existed even in the past. There were people who would say, you know, well, I like this, irrespective of the Quran and the Imam, whatever they say. Now that mentality, modernity now has become self-centered. Whatever I want, whatever I like, I want my religion to make it halal for me. And that is now becoming a collective issue. You know, the whole definition of marriage is changing. Even some of the Christian churches are defining what it means, you know, when it comes to marriage. It's no more just Adam and Eve. It could even be Adam and Steve. When we talk about that, this is where we have to realize, what do we mean by modernity? Is it following the desires, or is it following the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And that is the biggest challenge, and we can always, you know, overcome that challenge by going back to our roots and our traditions of Islam as taught by the Ahlul Bayt alayhimus salatu wassalam. Assalamu alaikum.